issue we have to deal with today is an issue which is really very, very common, and it's one of those specialist kind of cases and questions that comes again and again and again. And it is related to the topic of magic and the topic of the jinn, but very specifically to a certain case within the topic of magic and within the topic of the jinn, and that is the issue of fertility problems or problems having children. And when does that relate to the jinn, and how can we deal with that in terms of an Islamic cure involving ruqya or involving anything else? And then we want to talk about sort of more specific cases. What happens when you can prove that it's related to the jinn, when there's all sorts of jinn related activity going on, and then is our approach any different? So that's what we want to deal with today, insha'Allah ta'ala. The first point that we want to deal with is that whenever we have an issue that could potentially be from, let's say, worldly or normal causes, and could also be from, let's say, unworldly or unnatural causes, i.e. magic or the jinn, then we have to deal with it in two ways. Because if you're watching this video and you're having this kind of problem, then it may well be that you are suffering from a natural medical issue. And it may well be that you're suffering from a jinn-related issue. So how do we deal with this? I mean, a lot of people would start by saying, well, what are the criteria for us to decide whether it is a jinn problem or whether it is a medical problem? And I would say that's not necessary to do at all. We don't need to even go there. We can solve this problem by dealing with both at the same time. In other words, what I'm asking you to do if you're suffering from this problem is I'm asking you to presume it is a medical problem and to presume that it is a jinn-related problem and to deal with the two at the same time. Likewise, we can add a third issue in there. What about if this is a test from Allah, as people say, if this is something that is coming from the decree of Allah, and you know, it's not a magic issue, it's not a medical issue, this is a test from Allah Azza wa Jal. Put that in the mix as well and deal with all three of those with a separate and distinct action, which if it is A, will solve the problem, if it is B, will solve the problem, and if it is C, will solve the problem, because there's no contradiction in the cure for all of those three things. So let's talk the easy one first of all. It's a medical problem. So how are you going to deal with it if it's a medical problem? You're going to go to the doctor, have all the tests done, have the treatments, and generally, as long as those treatments are not harmful, as long as there's no high risk procedure where the doctor says, you know, this could cause you to become severely ill, as long as it's not high risk, you can pretty much take that road while doing the other two as well. What are the other two? Or what about if this is something that is natural, but it is coming from, you know, a test from Allah Azza wa Jal and a trial from Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. So how are we going to get ourselves out of that? Well, we actually find that there are things mentioned in the Quran and in the Sunnah which can relieve this kind of problem and bring about the result that you want. From them are the topic of istighfar, seeking forgiveness. Because Allah said, فَقُلْتُ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ غَفَّارًا يُرْسِلِ السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِدَرَارًا وَيُمْدِدُكُمْ بِأَمْوَالٍ وَبَنِينَ وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ جَنَّاتٍ وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ أَنْهَارًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said on the tongue of Nuh, relating to us in the Quran, what Nuh said to his people, that Nuh said, and I said to them, seek the forgiveness of your Lord. Indeed, He is always forgiving. He will send down rain from the sky in abundance, and He will give you an increase of wealth and children, and He will give you gardens and will give you rivers. All you have to do to get all of that in one package is to seek the forgiveness of Allah. And by that, I don't mean sitting in your home saying, Astaghfirullah, 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 but actually feeling it, meaning it, thinking about it, asking, what have I done that I'm seeking forgiveness from? Making all of these long and complicated dua for seeking forgiveness. Allahumma ighfir li dhanbi kulla, diqqahu wa jilla, awwalahu wa akhirahu, sirrahu wa alana. Oh Allah, forgive me all of my sins, those that I did openly, those that I did secretly, those that are small, those that are big, and to the end of the dua. So you're making these kind of complicated or complex long duas, seeking Allah's forgiveness, saying things like Astaghfirullah al-Azim alladhi la ilaha illa hu al-hayyu al-qayyum wa atubu ilayh. I seek the forgiveness of Allah, the one that there is no God worthy of worship but Him. Al-Hayyu al-Qayyum, the ever-living, the one who sustains all existence, and I turn to Him in repentance, and actually turning to Him in repentance. As we've alluded to, not only istighfar but dua, you know, waking up at tahajjud time, standing at the time when Allah Azza wa Jal descends to the lowest heaven. And then He says, is anyone seeking forgiveness, any of my slaves seeking forgiveness so I can forgive them? Is anyone asking me a question so that I can answer them? At that time, you know, the time between the Imam sits down at Jumu'ah, at the time between the Adhan and the Iqamah, and all of these other times when your du'as are accepted, and you're spending that time asking Allah to bless you with a pious child. As an example from the du'as that you can use is the du'a of Zakariya. وَزَكَرِيَّا إِذْ نَادَى رَبَّهُ رَبِّي لَا تَذَرْنِي فَرْدًا وَأَنْتَ خَيْرُ الْوَارِثِينَ. My Lord, don't leave me alone. Fardan means alone or with no children, barren with no children, and you are the best of the inheritors. That's one dua that you can use. There are others mentioned in the Quran, in the Sunnah. There are too many to mention in just this short clip, but the point is that you are making dua, you're making istighfar, you're seeking Allah's forgiveness, and you are intending to do something good with this gift that you are given. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in the Quran, لَإِن شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. If you show gratitude to Allah, Allah will give you more. So if you show gratitude for what you have, and if you intend to show gratitude through that child, not like the example that Allah Azza wa Jal gave in the Quran of the one who begged Allah for a pious child, and then when Allah gave them that child, they made partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not like this example, like the one who intends that if I have this child, I will raise them as a good Muslim. I will teach them to obey Allah Azza wa Jal, inshaAllah. And you have that intention, which is there. You observe the correct etiquettes between husband and wife, even in issues like marital intimacy. You don't do anything haram in that. You observe the dua before embarking on that. You have all of the right etiquettes. You make the wudu afterwards, for example, or the ghusl when necessary. And you know, there are etiquettes that you follow. Because the more you follow the sunnah, the more barakah you will find in the action that you do. And there are commands in the sunnah that relate to marital intimacy, relations between husband and wife. And so if you follow the sunnah in this regard, it's much more likely that you're going to get the result that you want out of it in terms of that child that you want. And of course, you have to recognize that Allah Azza wa Jal is the only one that can solve this problem for you, because at the end of the day, Allah is the one, to some He gives sons, to some He gives daughters, to some He doesn't give any children at all. And so He is the one you need to seek that help from. At the same time, Allah Azza wa Jal commands us to do what we call al-akhthu bil-asbab. Go out and do the causes. Go out and do the reasons for things to happen. So go to the doctor, seek some help. Recognizing that the doctor alone will not help you, that the help is going to come from Allah. But this is a cause, a sabab, a cause that Allah has placed in this world for you to act upon and for you to try out. And you never know where the help of Allah is going to come from. So right now we've dealt with this first point of it being a medical problem. We've dealt with what if it is a test from Allah and the need of patience and dua and istighfar and all of these other things that we understand when it relates to a test of Allah. But what if it is the third one? What if it is magic or the jinn that is causing this problem? If you suspect that, then I would recommend that you start doing a ruqya treatment. Now, one of the things we say, one of the most beautiful things about ruqya is that it's not a harmful treatment. It's not like a medicine that has side effects. You know, you take a medication, you take a drug, and that drug has side effects, and it could cause your hair to fall out, or it could cause you to become sick, or it could cause you to develop an allergy, or it could cause lots of things. Ruqya doesn't cause any problems at all. You can do ruqya when there's nothing wrong with you at all, and it won't cause any side effects. It has no downside. So if you think it's a problem related to that, and especially if you start to see some evidence that it is, and this brings us to the second part of the question, with regard to someone who says, well, I've seen some pretty reasonably strong evidence that it is a jinn problem. For example, I've seen figures around the home. I've seen strange things appearing, you know, sort of on the body, marks, spots, bruises. I've seen nightmares. I wake up at 3 a.m. every morning and see a face in front of me, sleep paralysis, and all these different sort of things. I'm seeing something there that is indicating to me that it is a jinn issue. So we can put those two together, the one who's fairly sure and the one who's 50-50, because the treatment is the same. We need to use the ruqya treatment along with the istighfar, along with the dua, along with the intention for gratitude, along with the medical treatment, because it doesn't hurt either. And along with that, we're going to use this ruqya treatment. And as an example, I would always say, you know, ruqya treatments are hard to describe in a short time, but I'll just give you sort of a what I would recommend someone to do. I would recommend at least 45 minutes of ruqya a day. I would recommend that ruqya to comprise of Surah Al-Fatiha, and I would recommend it to comprise of Ayatul Kursi, and I would recommend it to comprise of Al-Kafirun, Al-Ikhlas, Al-Falaq, and Al-Nas, that is the four quls at the end of the Quran. And I would recommend that they are repeated over a period of about 45 minutes, along with some du'as for ruqya like أَذْهِبِ الْبَأْسَ رَبَّ النَّاسِ إِشْفِي وَأَنْتَ الشَّافِي لَا شِفَاءَ إِلَّا شِفَاءُكْ شِفَاءً لَا يُغَادِرُ سَقَمًا. Oh Allah, make the pain, make the sickness go away, Rob, or Lord of mankind, cure, and you are the curer. There is no cure except your cure, a cure that does not leave behind any sickness, as an example. And there are many, many other du'as that you can get, and again, this video is too short to mention them all.